Hi guys, JCM here. While working on the series for Presence, I had an idea for a deep dive that I deem relevant as a swan song or extended piece. I've covered some of the events from Led Zeppelin's 1977 tour before, but there was a disturbing thought in the back of my mind recently that struck me and brought some writer's insomnia. Robert Plant's 29th birthday was not a celebration day but grief and tea for one. He lost his son and his childhood idol, who inspired him to be a musician. The juxtaposition of both tragic events is profound and symbolic. An innocent child and the world's greatest rock and roll singer both left this world on a Tuesday, 21 days apart from each other. Millions of fans mourned Elvis. Zeppelin fans were shocked, and only a small group could and cared to understand Robert's pain. The most popular concert tickets in the United States of 1977 vanished. The sound of heavy amplification, instruments, and cheers turned into deafening silence. Two concert tours that nobody wanted to stop crumbled and crashed. Both artists had an economic impact beyond the stage. Promoters, label executives, assistants, roadies, technicians, radio stations, merchandise, airplanes, pilots, dealers, physicians, publicists, lawyers, local tourism wherever they played, and adrenaline shots to the arm of the music industry. Truth of the matter is, some within their camps thought about stopping, but how could they? The business became bigger than themselves, and hysterical fans needed them. The show must go on. Where Led Zeppelin was a band and struggling team by then, Elvis carried the heavy burden of the solo artist, a lonely place supporting many, but fading away in solitude. Elvis Presley's last shows in the US occur in the midst of health issues and negligence from management, pushing the king to the extreme. Led Zeppelin's last shows in the US followed a similar playbook, with no bandmate casualties but violence, addiction, and evil vibes surrounding the empire. Elvis wore his sundial suit for his last two shows at Riverfront Coliseum on June 25th and Market Square Arena on June 26th. Led Zeppelin played these same venues in reverse on April 17th, 19th, and 20th. In the footsteps of the king himself, a special backdrop showing an image of the sun was used at Led Zeppelin's last US show at Oakland. Both artists had dates in August cancelled and time stood still. The shows that never happened, a turning point in vibration shift for rock and roll. Led Zeppelin got their tragic wake-up call from excess in a way they couldn't have imagined, and a parent's worst nightmare. Elvis got his wake-up call. The king died at 42 years old on August 16, 1977. Led Zeppelin went on indefinite hiatus. At Mark Bolan's death and Lynyrd Skynyrd's plane crash, and the statement is absolute, the song did not remain the same. Disco soon arrived and the rock and roll world carried on, hurt and confused. I'll revisit the events, sights and characters of 1977 as a musical essay and add a chapter to the present story that puts into perspective just how epic and dramatic Led Zeppelin's final visit to the state was. A great concert year for the business and the fans, but like the New York blackout in July, a light and shade voyage of personal turmoil, big bucks, and decadent starships. The musical setting where Elvis Presley and the Zeppelin tours happened was a fortune battlefield of expectations and the enormous pressure to deliver as industry leaders. Did you know Judas Priest opened for Led Zeppelin at Oakland? This is a JCM retrospective on the Elvis Presley-Led Zeppelin connection. The final concerts in the United States of 1977.
Good evening. Elvis Presley died today. He was 42. Apparently it was a heart attack. He was found at his home in Memphis, not breathing. His road manager tried to revive him. He failed. A hospital tried to revive him. It failed. His doctor pronounced him dead at 3 o'clock this afternoon. The end at an early age of one of the two most spectacular careers in the history of American entertainment.
Elvis Presley was the king, no question. In terms of fame, financial success, and cultural impact, his musical ability and stage presence remains quintessential in the rock and roll world. His manager, Colonel Tom Parker, remains the perfect example of how not to treat the artist. May 11th, 1974, Peter Grant and Led Zeppelin went to an Elvis Presley show at the LA Forum. Because both artists were represented by Concerts West, promoter Jerry Weintraub managed to arrange a meeting. Here's Robert Plant talking about Elvis and when Led Zeppelin met the King himself.
And for me as a kid, you know, I lived in England, and the whole radio setup, the whole exposure to music was really very muted. The post-war Britain was a very dour and very sort of understated and a place of where there wasn't a lot of dynamism. And as a kid, didn't know what was going on, you know, I was about 9 or something like that, and this voice came across in amongst Pat Boone and Johnny Mathis and all the stuff that was part of the Valium that we still know about today. Elvis came straight through, and he had the Blue Note. He was listening to, he got all this stuff, Mystery Train, Junior Parker's Blue Flames. I didn't know anything about the references. I didn't know anything about what I know now, where it came from, but I heard that voice. And no matter how his image has been maligned and how it ended up, when I met Elvis with Led Zeppelin one evening in L.A.
Oh, that alone. Hold it. Let's pause for a minute.
Yeah, well, Elvis wanted to know who was this. He'd adopted a kid when he was in the forces in Germany in 1959, some sort of pen pal extremity thing, whatever it was. And this kid was a bit younger than the King himself and was into Zeppelin. And we were involved with some people around that time who were booking out Elvis too. And Elvis wanted to know who was this bunch of guys who was selling tickets quicker than him. And so they said, it's Led Zeppelin. And we went to see him two or three times. And a couple of times he made mistakes. And I remember that night at the Forum, he was doing something like Reconsider Baby or whatever it was, the Lowell Fulson song.
Yeah.
And he stopped it and he said, wait a minute, we've got Led Zeppelin in here tonight, we've got to get this right. And I went, I mean.
Well, hello there.
Wait a minute, hold it. If we could start together, fellas, because we got Led Zeppelin out there and Jimmy Darin and a whole bunch of people. And let's try to look like we know what we're doing. What are we doing? Now, what were we doing?
So I mopped the tears away, and we got the nod that we were going to meet him afterwards. And we went to the hotel, and they had the entire top floor. No motorbikes or snakes. they just had these trestle tables with a couple of big guys. And they ushered us to a suite down the hall. It was a tacky place. It was great. It was all purples and browns. And, you know,
he carried that with him, I believe.
Yeah, well, there's nothing wrong with that. the room was filling up with sort of secondhand Anne Margaret's. Yeah. There was a lot of heads.
Well, you know, it has to be said, a secondhand Anne Margaret is
nothing
still...
Nothing wrong with that, thank you. And the hall, at the end of this huge suite, which was almost as big as this room, a door kept opening and somebody kept popping their head around. And then the door opened and this guy came through the door and I just, my heart jumped. It was like, whoa, look at the way he moves. And I mean, he was just going around chairs like... He was so cool. And I mean, of course, he wasn't supposed to be cool, but he was... And he came over to us and we stood in a circle for about... 2 or 3 hours talking, and people kept coming by from his retinue, from his entourage, thinking that he had enough. He was going, no. We had a great conversation. And our manager, Led Zeppelin's manager, Peter Grant, is sort of quite well known as probably as much as John Paul Jones, you know, big guy, a very great presence about him. And Peter was just going past us on the way to taking a seat somewhere in the homage area. And he lost his footing a bit like our friend there, and he 350 pounds of joy ended up on Vernon Presley's lap on it. And we talked with Presley for about three hours. It just went on and on, and we were talking about the root and your question about where did it come from. It came from him, and he still got it. He still was into that whole Delta thing. He, you know, Good Rocking Tonight, all that stuff that got him going in the first place. But he also knew, and he had a great sense of humor, and he knew that he was locked in this self-parody. I mean...
Plant's comments about Elvis being trapped are revealing, as it speaks of his growing sentiments within Led Zeppelin past physical graffiti. You see, late period Elvis Presley became the physical and mental embodiment of Led Zeppelin's fate knocking at their door. Although Peter Grant was nothing like Elvis's manager, and looked out for the boys. His personal demons grew and slowly lost control of the business through a similar stubbornness like Tom Parker. Both reached their level of incompetence with the stakes of fame so goddamn high. Let's take a look at the concert stats for Elvis Presley's latter-day period. 1974, 136 shows. 1975, 101 shows. 1976, 126 shows. A stark contrast to Led Zeppelin, who did 37 shows in 1975. What Elvis needed was to stop touring and regain his physical and mental health. By 1977, Elvis was overworked, tired, addicted to prescription drugs, financially exploited by his manager, and surrounded by an army of yes-men catering to his desires and demands. So how did Led Zeppelin avoid this trap of show business at the height of their success? The reason is plain and simple. Robert Plant's car accident in 1975. This took them off the road and they were able to buy time away from the madness of touring. But if we look at the market back then, there was a huge demand for Led Zeppelin shows. We tend to think they wouldn't have continued and just go back home, but we cannot forget this was a business. Greed happens to be human. You mix that with substance and ego and well, there will be blood. Had they continued in the winter of 75 and booked more shows in 76, walking close to questionable lifestyle choices of the rockstar world was inevitable. By July 1977, Led Zeppelin was three legs into the tour, with some of its members and crew getting deep into the Elvis Presley waters of excess, isolation, and health issues like malnutrition and gastrointestinal episodes. The organization was bloated, tired, and directionless. Elvis Presley was represented in four different ways in Led Zeppelin. Robert Plant had to rest his leg in the acoustic set and watched alienation take shape. Bonham fought the demons of one of the most demanding drumming jobs in rock and roll. Jones kept the musician side of things surrounded by darkness. Page was the physical demise, and like Presley, he hid behind iconic outfits, delivering what the people wanted to see and listen. Clapping never ending to the myth, chanting never silent at all the glitters turning to gold. Like Elvis, Zeppelin fans were not there for their latest record presence, but for their previous works and movie. They wanted the costumes, lights, and theatrics. Led Zeppelin was not a prisoner of itself. They kept going for miles. They walked on borrowed time, and like Presley, they had a private doctor on board. Elvis got high on prescription drugs. The Zeppelin crew took everything they could get their hands on. Peter Grant talked to Colonel Tom Parker about promoting a European tour for Elvis. Don Arden tried to get him in the 60s but failed. Elvis' addiction to painkillers made him a potential target for the authorities in Britain. Peter was up for the challenge. He needed a challenge after 1975. Atlantic's Emmett Ertegun once called Peter Grant the English version of Tom Parker. Carrick, Plant, and Elvis Presley passed away. There was no more Led Zeppelin or plans for Presley in Europe. The world stopped, and it probably saved Page, Plant, Jones, and Bonham's lives away from decadent temptations on the road. Robert and Jones had cleaned up their act. Jimmy didn't look healthy at Nebworth 1979, nor Europe 1980. Bonzo, having second thoughts on going back to the States, as well as his physical shape and habits, were unattended. The lesson from Elvis Presley was not learned. His fate was tragically repeated. January 1st, Lynyrd Skynyrd launched their Street Survivors Tour, or Tour of the Survivors, with three shows in the United States before going to Asia and Europe until March 1st. They returned to the US in April and played live until October 19th at Greenville, South Carolina. Three band members, lead vocalist Ronnie Van Zandt, guitarist Steve Gaines, and his sister vocalist Cassie Gaines, were killed in a plane crash the next day. January 2nd, Ted Templeman watched Van Halen play at the Starwood in West Hollywood. He helped them get signed by Warner and produced their debut album from August to September. The band played 46 days in California with a recurring venue, The Whiskey. They would hit stadium-sized arenas by April 1978. RCA producer Felton Jarvis booked a recording studio in Nashville, Tennessee to record some new tracks chosen by Elvis Presley. He never showed up for the session, claiming that he was sick and stayed home. By this point, Elvis was not excited about the studio. Back in England, the Zeppelin continued their tour rehearsals in London, while many rock bands were already on the road, or about to. While most artists were promoting commercially successful albums, the Zeppelin was the only band of its size to have the luxury of touring with a low-charting studio album. Fans didn't care. They wanted to see their idols, which speaks volumes of their popularity musicianship, and cult status. I said it on the making of Presence and I'll say it again. This was a tour for The Song Remains the Same movie. People wanted to see Jimmy's moves in violin bow, Bonham's epic drum solo, Plant's pose and mannerisms, and Jones's multi-instrumentalist chops. Add in cuts from Physical Graffiti and it's everything but promoting Presence. I believe this contributed to what Plant states as the fishbowl sensation of these travels. Where every other concert tour was based around hot-selling records, 1977 is a fascinating marketing anomaly that proved a point. They were up there with Elvis, in ticket sales, and profits. Their music life was now a fantasy sequence. The first month of 1977 had many bands playing US tours ready to cash in their studio efforts. From progressive rock's Jethro Tull and Rush to symphonic frenzy ELO, they followed the concert venue circuit like a roadmap for riches. Playing at the Forum and Madison Square Garden was a must, a rite of passage in the business. Queen led the trail as one of the biggest British bands that year to conquer the same places where Zeppelin excelled in America. Their European leg included Earl's Court to crown themselves the next big band for years to come. Black Sabbath continued their technical ecstasy tour, and Bob Seger performed 60 shows in the US alone. January 25th, 1977, Led Zeppelin's press release announced their first live performances in 2 years. The whole tour was sold out a week later in record time. Many venues saw tickets fly out the window in just 3 hours. An estimated 1.3 million people would see the band. Questions ran within the organization. How much bigger could it get? The second batch of touring bands took the States by storm in the ways of Boston, Genesis, and Billy Joel, who recorded The Stranger midway through 1977. It became the fourth best-selling album of the year. David Coverdale released his first solo album. He would use the name for his future band, and Robert Plant had no beef with him back then. The B-52s played their first show ever in Georgia, while Stevie Wonder scored the Album of the Year Grammy for Songs in the Key of Life. February 24th, Fleetwood Mac played the first show of their gigantic Rumours tour. Their North American leg saw them play 69 concerts all the way through October, with every venue from the rock and roll market covered, including 2 nights at the Garden and 3 nights at the Forum. The tour ran until August 30th, 1978, for a total of 5 legs and 96 shows. Released on February 4th, Rumours was the third best-selling record of 1977, behind Saturday Night Fever and Meatloaf's Bat Out of Hell. A record that, with all the respect, I hate. I still cannot understand why it was so successful. March 3rd, 1977. Robert Plant contracted tonsillitis, thus some Led Zeppelin shows had to be rescheduled, including opening night. Elvis returned to Memphis after his February concerts. His father urged him to sign a will, which designated Vernon Presley as executor with total responsibility of the state. Elvis flew to Hawaii for some vacation time where he seemed relaxed away from the stress of the music business. Presley's personal plane went by the name of Lisa Marie. It was similar to a Boeing 707 and it was purchased in 1975 at $250,000. He had it refurbished with a price tag of $800,000. The king had money and spared no expense. Peter Gabriel played his first solo tour in the States with a band of 2 guitar wizards, Steve Hunter and King Crimson's Robert Fripp, plus Tony Levin on bass. The success of Salisbury Hill from his debut album was a sign of things to come. Emerson, Lake and Palmer released their Works Volume 1 double album, while Jeff Beck's live album with Ian Hammer cemented their legacy in jazz fusion. April 1st, Elvis went back to Memphis. He was admitted to the Baptist Hospital after canceling a show at the last minute in Baton Rouge. He had complaints of intestinal flu. Led Zeppelin played their first show of their tour in Dallas. They flew aboard Caesar's Chariot, a Boeing 720 45-seat plane at a daily fee of $2,500. Their previous Starship was permanently grounded due to engine difficulties. The Swan Song logo of the Fallen Angel was not the best image for a plane. Peter Grant brought tough guy John Bindon for security, as the band received many death threats. Mixed that with cocaine paranoia, and it seemed like a necessity to have his presence. Robert Plant hated Bindon being there. Richard Cole was confused too. His violent methods and ways added to the dark cloud of short-tempered management and liabilities on the tour. The staff now included personal assistants and drug buddies, including Dr. Larry, who provided his expertise to the Rolling Stones before. He had a bag of pills and substances. Swan Song gave specific instructions to journalists. These included never asking questions outside the music, and do not talk to Peter Grant nor Richard Cole for any reason. Logistics within the Zeppelin camp had changed. The band's tardiness was present at more than one show, but because the money was coming in at such a rapid pace, the cracks in the organization were ignored. April 5th, Elvis Presley was released from Baptist Hospital at 4 a.m. Newspapers said, quote, "He's feeling fine and looking forward to returning to his personal appearance tours that begin on April 21st at Greensboro." Colonel Tom Parker said he was okay. End of story. Foreigner's U.S. tour began in Washington, D.C. and lasted through October. Their self-titled record was among the top 10 best-selling albums of the year, and like Boston, it set the controls for future corporate rock and their of 80s bands.
Gastroenteritis, which is something that isn't helped by firecrackers, but it isn't brought on by them. So we're going to take a necessary 5-minute break right now. So you must bear with us, because Jimmy is very lucky to be even playing tonight. Okay? Can you give us 5 minutes, please? Of gastroenteritis. He does not want to do a half-hearted show tonight. If you watch the press and the papers on Monday, and hang on to your ticket stubs, this show will be rescheduled and all your tickets will be re-honored. The band feel very bad about this, but please hang on to your tickets and they will all be rescheduled for the next performance, and when they come back and replay this show again.
So I want to discuss Led Zeppelin's average tour setlist for 1977. I revisited a lot of the recordings and made my notes. Conceptually speaking, this is like Earl's Court on steroids. You can tell that being off the road since May 75 had them hungry to show everybody they were still the kings of rock and roll. The heavy stuff regained their early career levels of bombastic thunder, courtesy of tour MVP John Bonham. His playing, crazy fills, and lightning hits throughout all 44 shows were excellent and rescued many songs many times. Even Bonzo's lesser performance at San Diego Sports Arena on June 19th was a solid drumming venture. Led Zeppelin's live sound really depended on his magic. Mix this with Jones's metallic sounding alembic bass, and it's as metal as many metal bands wish they could be. I know the alembic bass throws some Zeppelin fans off, but please revisit these shows at max volume and you'll appreciate it, guaranteed. Your neighbors won't. Opening the set with The Song Remains the Same was one of the best creative decisions ever. It worked in all the right places and it gave Plant enough time to warm up, unlike previous years. Yes, it was demanding for Bonzo, but he seemed to empty his nerves in here and get everyone in motion. A great Song Remains the Same is a sign of a great 77 show. Sick Again with the Rover as intro was a badass statement on rockstar vibrations. The 1975 versions just didn't have this level of anger and confidence. And because they played hard, Nobody's Fault But Mine fits perfect as a third number. The monster groove and raspy vocals are backed up by a lethal string section. All versions from the tour are worth listening. In My Time of Dying makes absolute sense next. It lowers the tempo but further develops the blues motifs from Presence into the mystique of physical graffiti. Next is Since I've Been Loving You. As you can see, they technically play three blues numbers in a row and slow the tempo with each. This one worked wonders. Yes, they could have done T for One, but in context, it may have been a bit too depressing for the excitement of stadium-sized venues. While Jimmy's guitar was off during early parts of all three concert legs, when he was on, it was brilliant. Robert showcases phrasing, releasing his demons, and letting the pain go away. There is an issue with the next two songs, I'll explain. No Quarter and 10 Years Gone should have traded places for a greater effect. The wild and crazy jams of No Quarter on this tour were so good, the second best after 1973, I mean, they were so out there. Jones's mini piano concertos, blues boogies, Bonham beating his steel drums with no mercy, Jimmy's lead guitar magic, and Robert's howling vocals. After this massive display of technique, 10 Years Gone sounds awkward. You can't go singing about nostalgia and past lovers after the Dogs of Doom have shaken the earth. 10 Years Gone takes some of the mystery away and brings it to reality way too soon. Although the rhythm section and vocals were solid, Jimmy's soloing on his Telecaster was quite uneven. Some versions were ruined by his erratic playing. I'm sorry, Jimmy, as much as I love this track, your playing sometimes was just off. I don't know if he was nervous, but the song requires a delicate touch. Sometimes it sounded a bit harsh. Okay, now to the acoustic set. It worked at Elle's Court and it works here. They ditched That's the Way for Black Country Woman. What a perfect song for this tour, with Bonham back on drums and Jones on uptight bass. Out of all four songs from the acoustic segment, Battle of Evermore was a bit of a stretch with Jumple Jones on vocals. While it doesn't sound bad, really, there's something missing, and I think it's the bass frequencies. It falls flat trying to capture the essence of the studio version, also known as the Misty Mountain Hop effect. It's funny how the fourth album was so hard to replicate live, right? Kudos to Jumple Jones for singing. That took some guts. White Summer, Black Mountain Side gave Jimmy's bandmates a quick rest while he revisited this track not performed live since August 31st, 1971. It was a return to the improvisation vibes of the early tours, and the best musical setting for Kashmir to come in full force. What can I say about this one? Although the 1975 versions of Kashmir with Jimmy's Les Paul were great, Bonham's steel drums in 1977 were a huge upgrade for the sound. He stole the show in every performance of the song. Check out any version from the tour except Arizona. They're all incredible. They're all great. Okay, now to the instrumental solo spots. Both Bonzo and Page shine on these. Yes, I know they may be boring for some, but the sounds they pulled off with the help of technology are innovative. It's quite an experience for the listener. I believe they were ahead of their time in places. This is what a live show is about, the element of surprise and entertainment. Placing Achilles' Last Stand next to the guitar solo was clever. It allowed Jimmy to play the intro like one big progressive rock piece. Achilles was just brutal on this tour, thanks to, once again, MVP John Bonham. He rescued Jimmy Page in more than one occasion when he was falling down the sloppy soloing cliff. Jones held the harmony together with brilliance, and Plan really enjoyed playing this former wheelchair song. From this point on, Zeppelin was in autopilot from The Song Remains the Same movie. How else could you finish the shows but with Stairway to Heaven, Hold Out Love, and Rock and Roll, right? All three songs were performed with passion. They sounded revived, where the 1975 versions were sluggish, especially Stairway, which Plan seems to enjoy for the very last time before Carrick's passing. Playing just a portion of Hold Out Love without the space jam and just going into rock and roll was a great idea. Concise and straight to the point, all versions from the tour are breathtaking. They performed Over the Hills and Far Away towards the end of the tour, and well, the instrumental section is powerful, with that 1977 metallic sound elevating the track to newfound greatness. Plant's voice couldn't hit the old notes, but enjoyed it nevertheless. Trample Underfoot had a similar result, but it didn't add much to their great setlist. It sounded a bit generic and tired compared to other songs here. All the other encores like Heartbreaker, Black Dog, and Communication Breakdown are killer. They managed to outdo their 1975 performances like a personal redemption, leaving a lasting memory in their last visit to America. 1977 had the spirit of 1969, with the diversity of 1973. We might get sloppy guitar solos and vocal missteps sometimes, but this is rock and roll. It takes chances, and they conquer North America. Again. The show had everything. It was a perfect summary of their career, and it set the backbone for Nebworth, Europe 1980, and the 2007 reunion. Please go ahead and revisit shows from this era. It's worth a trip. Be sure to wear headphones or play them loud on your speakers. I believe the reason for Robert Plant's hesitation on Zeppelin reunions is the fact that time stopped for him in 1977. His solo career has been an exploration of pre- or post-Zeppelin vibes, rarely in between. Robert cannot go back to pre-1977 days and act as if nothing happened. The more you appreciate revisiting the 1977 shows, the more 1979-1980 Zeppelin feels like a reunion. There wasn't much more to do once Robert's heart was out through the inn door. On the next episode of the Elvis Presley-Led Zeppelin Connection, the band begins the second leg of the tour. Elvis Presley needs medical assistance in Baltimore. A wild thunderstorm in Tampa starts a nasty riot, and the final days of 1977 reach their tragic finales. Stay tuned for more. Bye-bye.